In our previous lecture, we looked at Immanuel Kant and his deontological or non-consequentialist teachings related to morality. In this lecture, we're going to be looking at an alternative known as utilitarianism with Jeremy Bentham and John Stuart Mill.
Our very first philosopher that will introduce teachings that will develop later into utilitarianism is Jeremy Bentham. This philosophy of utilitarianism will come about in part due to the Industrial Revolution taking place in Western Europe. That Industrial Revolution creates a political conflict that still today, centuries later, is the primary political conflict that we have in Western society. In its most extreme forms, we see the two opposing sides of this raging political debate being unbridled conservative capitalism and, on the other end, liberal socialism. And Jeremy Bentham would be an example of the latter of these two, of what the political philosophy of liberal socialism. Now, Bentham was a philosophical hedonist. Just to remind you what that term means, it means that you view life as primarily having pleasure or happiness as its primary end. This places him in stark contrast to Immanuel Kant, who we just studied. Please remember that Kant believed that an action or a person was good in and of itself or of himself. Bentham, however, believed that good was always equated with the amount of pleasure received and the amount of pain avoided. So a thing or a person cannot be good in and of itself, but it would be the experience of pleasure or the absence of the experience of pain that would make a thing good or ethical or moral. Now, whether conscious of it or not, Bentham argues that we always act to achieve pleasure and avoid pain, that this is just part of the human condition. This is termed psychological hedonism, and because this seems to be the universal human condition, for Bentham, this develops into ethical hedonism, which means it is the ethical thing, the moral thing, the right thing to do, to seek pleasure and increase pleasure in your life and avoid or decrease pain. Now, Bentham wanted to try to make this a more scientific presentation of an ethic or a system of morality, and so he created what is referred to as the hedonic calculus. And through these seven questions that he asks, he tries to analyze our perceptions of pleasure and pain, and he believes that the answers to these seven questions could give you some sort of scientific or empirical outlook on how happy or moral your life is. You certainly don't need to know all seven questions, although they are listed in the textbook for you. But just as a couple of examples, one question is, how long will the pleasure last? Or another question is, how soon will the pleasure occur? Now, most importantly, and this really needs to be a focus on this slide for your notes here, Bentham's hedonism was not based on an individual's experience of pleasure. Bentham argued that we are happiest as a society when the most people possible are experiencing the most pleasure possible. So I know with what you've heard previously on this side, it sounds like it could be very egotistical and individualistic. That's not what Bentham is speaking about here. He's talking about collectively, communally, as a society, we together need to seek pleasure, not just for ourselves, but for one another, for society as a whole. Bentham goes further to argue that if we focus only on our individual happiness and we attempt to ignore the misery of others, this will inevitably bring about the decay of our own happiness. So if you as an individual, if you're being egotistical and you're just seeking your own pleasure and you are ignoring the pain, the misery, the poverty of others, Bentham argues that eventually that plan will backfire on you and you will find yourself in a place of unhappiness. Jeremy Bentham eventually became good friends with a man named James Mill. James was a very stern and rigid man, and he had a son named John Stuart Mill. Bentham and James Mill decided to turn John Stuart Mill into their own sort of philosophical experiment to give him a profound education in a variety of areas of study and to really try to implant Bentham's own political and ethical philosophy on John Stuart Mill. Now, as Mill grew from boyhood into manhood, he did take the teachings of Jeremy Bentham, but he didn't stop there. He actually expanded those teachings into a much more mature and much more comprehensive philosophy known as utilitarianism. That's why we don't hear as much about Jeremy Bentham in philosophy as we do John Stuart Mill. He is seen as the one who actually brings about the mature, modern form of utilitarianism. Now, Bentham, you see this somewhat with the hedonic calculus. He attempts to be very scientific in implementing his philosophy. So he wants to be dispassionate, doesn't want to let his emotions get in the way, and he thinks that this will help him make objective evaluations of pleasure and pain. But Mill became convinced that compassion and empathy toward others were indispensable in making decisions about what brings the most pleasure or happiness to society as a whole. So rather than trying to be removed and dispassionate and even objective, Mill felt that you actually have to be involved in the situations of those who are dealing with pain or poverty in order to implement a utilitarian ethic to bring about greater justice in society. Now, unlike Bentham, Mill believed that the quality of pleasure was more important than the quantity of pleasure. That's what we see with Jeremy Bentham's hedonic calculus. It doesn't have any way of differentiating between different qualities of pleasure, but only the amount, the quantity of pleasure. And by the way, this is almost identical to something that you've seen earlier in the year when we looked at hedonism for the first time with Aristippus and Epicurus. We saw that Aristippus was only concerned about the amount, the quantity of pleasure that he could experience, where Epicurus was much more concerned with the quality of the pleasure. Now, personally, Mill struggled with bouts of depression throughout his life, but he remained an optimist about human nature. This, by the way, is one of the primary tenets of political liberalism, that humanity is getting morally better with each generation as their educational experience collectively increases, that if we could just educate people and have them learn the system of morality or ethics, then they will, generation by generation, become better people. Mill referred to this phenomena as the higher pleasures or the higher goods. Now, you have to be a much more disciplined person to achieve and experience these higher pleasures. You have to be willing to work hard to achieve these higher pleasures. But Mill argued that it is the consensus experience of those who have experienced two different types of pleasure that they will differentiate between one being a higher pleasure and the other being a lower pleasure. Mill was confounded, however, that the vast majority of people still seem to just settle for the lower pleasures rather than doing the hard work and having the discipline to strive after the higher pleasures. Just to give you an example of what this looks like, a movie that's made for nothing other than a cash cow at the box office, like Transformers Parts 7 or 8 or however many of those movies there are now, that's going to bring in a lot of money because it has this entertainment value with all the special effects and everything else. And it's not a very good script, but nonetheless, with all of the special effects, it brings in a lot of money. But you'll rarely see a movie like that ever nominated for a critical award, like an Academy Award or a Golden Globe, anything like that. And instead, those movies tend to have a much more artistic value. And so Mill is saying, you know, if you have someone watch these two different kinds of movies, for Mill, he actually used the example of music, of two different kinds of music, that there will be a classical piece of music that will be much more appreciated as the higher pleasure or the higher good. Mill's vision for the future, however, though it was optimistic, as I mentioned earlier, and he foresaw a day in which he hoped that the human race would evolve to embrace more and more of the higher pleasures, the good things, and thus become an increasingly more altruistic or charitable society, in which we finally realize and live out the conviction that our individual happiness is absolutely dependent on the happiness of others.